place? Gettysburg, in the state of Pennsylvania, in the United States of America. The year 1863. The small city nestled in the Pennsylvania mountains became an immortal name in the annals of war. It is a place where the bloodiest battle in the history of America was fought. It was here the Union armies met the armies of the Confederacy in the crucial and deciding conflict of the war between the states. In 1863, the cause of the Confederacy was at a crossroads. Their armies, usually victorious in the East, had been less successful in the West, where General Grant was threatening to capture Vicksburg and achieve control of the Mississippi River for the Union. With the West in jeopardy, General Robert E. Lee, in command of the armies of the East, formed a daring plan. He massed his forces for a quick and smashing victory in Pennsylvania that hopefully might bring a settlement in the war, and with it, the independence of the South. In early June, the Army of Northern Virginia was moving in the Shenandoah Valley. The Union Army, intent on protecting Washington, cautiously headed toward the north, east of the Blue Ridge, which enabled them to retain a good defense of the federal capital. On the 28th of June, 1863, General Lee's scouts reported that Meade's Union Army was near Frederick, Maryland. Lee, anticipating a critical struggle, decided to bring his scattered divisions into a compact force. And so it was that Confederates from Chambersburg, Carlisle, and York converged on the central point, Gettysburg. It is an odd circumstance that the Southern Army approached Gettysburg from the north and west, while the Northern Army approached the battlefield from the south. It was Lee's strategy to fight the impending battle near Cashtown, 8 miles to the west of Gettysburg, which provided better terrain for an attack. General Meade, in command of the Federal forces, preferred a more defensible position farther south. But advance forces of both armies came to grips at Gettysburg, and without realizing it, brought on the climactic struggle at a point where neither commanding general had actually planned to wage the battle. These peaceful rolling hills, which harbor the farms of the Germans and Scotch-Irish, were soon to be tormented by the terrible terror of war. Poised for the fight, and soon to be involved in it, were 75,000 determined Confederates, pitted against 93,000 equally determined Federal troops. Two small brigades of John Buford's Union cavalry, the eyes of the army, were the first troops on the field. From the cupola of the seminary building, Buford spotted the gray columns of Confederates winding through Cashtown Pass. Buford deployed his thin lines of defense in an attempt to bluff the Confederates into caution until the main Union army could arrive. Fighting dismounted, Buford and his men took up a position on McPherson Ridge. The battle opened with the firing of 3-inch guns. The crew, perhaps with an instinctive sense of history, marked the piece that fired the first shot. The opposing forces first saw each other as the Confederates appeared on Hare Ridge. By the time the Confederates discovered Buford's thin line of defense, they were prevented from taking advantage by the arrival of General Reynolds' Union infantry, which thundered into action and drove the advance gray line back across the valley. Reynolds was killed at this spot, a short moment after his men went into battle. Replacing him in command was Abner Doubleday of baseball fame. John Burns was a Gettysburg shoemaker, 70 years old and a veteran of the War of 1812. When the action started, John Burns shouldered his ancient musket, fell into line with Meredith's Iron Brigade, and fought valiantly throughout the first day. He was wounded 3 times, but survived to become a national hero. In addition to the attack on Hare Ridge, the Confederates had also launched an advance somewhat to the north. This second attack was repulsed by the 14th Brooklyn, the only regiment named for a city instead of a state. At noon of this first day, Union cavalry outposts reported that Confederates were approaching on the Carlisle Road. These Southern troops formed an artillery line on this ridge and shelled the Union force. When the Union reply to the shelling seemed feeble, the Confederates charged but were driven back with severe loss. Meanwhile, more Union troops under Howard arrived and were deployed on this level plain. The fighting lulled until 3 o'clock, when fresh Confederate reinforcements went into action. And now, under attack from west, north, and northeast, the Union troops were dislodged and driven back, still fighting defiantly as they retreated. Union General Barlow, who was badly wounded in the action, was captured and fell into the chivalrous hands of Confederate General Gordon, who made arrangements for Mrs. Barlow to be brought through the battle lines under a flag of truce in order to nurse her husband back to health. The Union troops retreated back through Gettysburg, which was now under artillery attack from the Confederates. When the higher ground south and east of Gettysburg was reached, the Union troops took positions, stood firm, and held the Confederates in check. During the night, the opposing lines took clearer shape and form. But by now, the North had the advantage that their bloody delaying action of the first day had brought them. They had higher ground and a shorter and more compact line. On the second day, the field was quiet until late afternoon. The Union side was willing to wait. Some of the Confederate forces, misdirected and delayed by Union tactics, could not be brought into play for attack. Lee's plan was to attack Union left and right flanks simultaneously. The Union 3rd Corps, forming the left flank, had been moved out to a V-shaped position, with the left at Devil's Den and the center at the Peach Orchard. The chief engineer of the Union forces was G.K. Warren. Scouting the terrain from a rock on Little Round Top, he realized that this was a supremely important position and must be held. No opposing force could be seen. But to be doubly sure, Warren ordered a battery on Devil's Den Ridge to fire into the woods that appeared beyond the White Barn. Watching the effect of the fire with his binoculars, he spotted the glint of sunlight on shiny metal as hidden Confederate troops scattered from the shell fire. Warren immediately called for reserves to help hold this vital position. The exposed and surprised Confederates struck back quickly and hard.
Come on, hold your bellies.
The Confederates swarmed over the lower slope of Big Round Top and up the south face of Little Round Top. Just at the critical moment, Union reserves summoned by Warren appeared and engaged the attackers at point-blank range.
Fire!
Up the hill!
Forward, men! Move! Come on!
Charge!
Finally, the added Union strength prevailed and slowly but surely pushed back the hard-fighting Confederates. Little Round Top, a strategic point, was saved. The Confederates reformed at Devil's Den. There, behind the shelter of rocks and barricades, their sharpshooters picked off Union soldiers and officers on the distant hill. During the night, the Northern forces built up rock breastworks of their own. The wheat field had been cleared of Union troops by the attacking Confederates, and General Meade summoned a division of reserves in an effort to regain it. Part of this division included the famous Irish Brigade, whose chaplain, Father William Corby, halted them for a moment, mounted a rock, and gave the troops conditional absolution. They regained the wheat field, but shortly after lost it again to attacking Confederate forces. Farther north, where the Union line had been weakened in an effort to support the left flank, two brigades of Confederate troops came pouring through a gap. General Hancock promptly ordered the 1st Minnesota Regiment to plug up the hole in the line. While hopelessly outnumbered, the impact of the desperate Minnesota attack checked the Confederate forces, giving Hancock enough time to realign his troops. But 82%, about 7 out of every 8 of the 1st Minnesota, lay killed or wounded on the battlefield. When nightfall ended the carnage in the second day of the battle, the Confederates had been held at bay in front of Cemetery Ridge and in the Culp's Hill sector, but the losses on both sides had been frightful. Light of the moon, men searched the bloody fields for dead or torn comrades while others rested, not knowing what grim business lay ahead of them on the third and final day of the battle. On the morning of the third day, there was some hard fighting near Spangler Spring. Then, there was quiet. During this lull, General Lee regrouped his forces. He was planning an attack on the right wing of the Federal lines, hoping to keep the Union's reserves occupied so that he might make a bold and sudden thrust through the center, hoping thereby to cut the opposing army in two parts. His plan also was to have Jeb Stuart's cavalry appear at the rear of the Union lines in order to complete the destruction. Union General Meade waited for the attack. His plan was to stand firm until the Confederates were well within range and then meet the attack head on and at both flanks. For 2 hours, beginning at 1 in the afternoon, Confederate artillery shelled the center of the Union lines with 138 guns. Thank you. Smoke from a great artillery duel clouded the field as the fire finally ceased. And then, led by General Pickett, 15,000 Confederates, lines dressed, stepping in cadence, followed their generals and their flags up Cemetery Ridge. As the magnificent Southern ranks marched into battle, General Meade and his Northern forces waited. Pickett's objective was a clump of oak trees. As they came into view, he swung his line slightly to the left and resumed the march. Guns from Round Top to Cemetery Ridge were belching and blasting iron death into the ranks of the Confederates. But they moved on. They crossed Emmitsburg Road, past Cadore's farmhouse, and then dashed for the stone wall.
Pound the attack!
General Meade's reserves moved into action at the clump of trees, which historians designate as the high water mark of the battle and of the war. Union troops attacked in the center and at both flanks. Hit from three sides, the Confederates had no alternative but retreat. Only 5,000 men, a third of the attacking Confederate forces, came back from the immortal charge. One soldier of the 26th North Carolina Regiment, a bullet hole through his own leg, reported that all 84 men in his company were casualties. The crisis at Gettysburg was over. But meanwhile, 3 miles east, a cavalry battle was being waged. Jeb Stuart, intent on his assignment, attacked the Union rear, but was met by Union cavalry under command of Gregg and George Armstrong Custer. Stuart's savage attack was beaten off after charge and countercharge, and Stuart, unable to reach his objective, finally withdrew. On the night of the following day, July 4th, 1863, General Lee began his retreat. The battle was over. The Union was saved. The total casualties in those three bitter and bloody days were 51,000. 51,000 casualties, or approximately 33% of the men involved. Among the casualties were many officers of brigade command rank or higher. 14 of these ranking officers were killed and 24 wounded. The armies moving from the battlefield took only a little time to inter the dead in shallow graves. And 20,000 wounded men were left in and around the village of 2,000 inhabitants. The war between the states raged for 2 more years, but the Southern cause was lost at Gettysburg. The decisive battle was recognized as such almost immediately. On November 19th, 1863, the Soldiers' Cemetery at Gettysburg was dedicated. To commemorate the solemn occasion, America's most famous orator, Edward Everett, was asked to speak. He talked for 2 hours. Little is known of the classical speech he delivered. He was followed by another speaker who had been asked as a matter of courtesy. His name was Abraham Lincoln. He spoke exactly 271 words, which have become an imperishable document in literature.
67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.